Let's talk about Taylor Swift. She went from being a hopeful young musician to a history-making Grammy Award-winning artist using one simple storytelling technique, the three-act structure. Today, we're going to talk about why that three-act structure, driven by five specific plot points, is the secret ingredient to the song that made Taylor famous. A song that, to this day, is one of the most successful pop songs of all time.
And the winner is the lovely Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift!
Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift!
But before we get to T-Swift, we have to talk about where the three-act structure actually comes from, and why creators are always talking about it. The three-act structure goes as far back as Aristotle, and is still used in most modern screenwriting, ranging from Quentin Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood to Disney's Moana. The idea is pretty simple. Divide the plot of a story into beginning, which is your exposition, the middle, your confrontation, and the end, a resolution. Three segments, or acts, they represent the rise and fall of action, and each act is initiated by a preceding plot point. And using this structure helps to place dynamic moments throughout the story, taking the audience along a gripping and emotional ride. Why is this structure so effective? Well, every communicator knows that people have a special ability to remember things in three. And even as a teenager, Taylor Swift understood this.
I find inspiration in human emotion. The way that we treat each other, the way that we make each other feel, and the pattern of it, and how, you know, it repeats itself so often, but we never learn from it.
She injected it into her songwriting with the release of her second album called Fearless.
And the next day is the album release, and I'll be back in Nashville. So we go to New York now, and then we'll be back by tomorrow night.
And no song better reflects the power of the three-act structure than the most popular song on that album, You Belong With Me. Taylor released You Belong With Me in April 2009, and it quickly became a top 10 hit worldwide. It was nominated for Song of the Year at the Grammys, went 7 times platinum, is one of the best-selling singles in history, and has become Taylor's 3rd best-selling single of all time. But You Belong With Me isn't telling some new story. You've seen it in the movies before. The classic story of the dorky girl, or the boy next door, stuck in the friend zone, pining over the friend who doesn't notice them until they take off their glasses and start seeing the world clearly. And this story is common because it works. It resonates with so many people. Everybody's felt like an underdog at one moment in time and maybe misunderstood at another. And so they root for that hero, that underdog, and they keep listening or watching to the end to see if that person gets their true love. Taylor tells this story especially well by following that classic three-act structure with the 5 major plot points. So let's break it down. Act 1 begins with our hero, the nerdy girl next door, Taylor, catching her next-door neighbor arguing on the phone with his girlfriend. She shows him and us that she cares for him. He smiles and responds with his own warm gesture. This leads to plot point number 1, the inciting incident, the moment that introduces the problem the protagonist must contend with. Taylor writes, "I love you," on her next note, but the boy has shut his blinds. She missed her chance, and we're not sure if she's ever gonna get it back. Then we see our hero acting on a false belief, thinking she has to be somebody other than herself to get what she wants. And this is a classic mechanism for getting the audience to empathize with your protagonist. I mean, after all, haven't we all tried to be somebody that we're not? And then, plot twist, the neighbor catches a glimpse of her dancing. And this is plot point number 2, the lock-in, signifying the end of Act 1. And the story goal is now established. We're hooked on the hope, wondering, does he like her back? Is Taylor willing to be true to herself? And of course, are they gonna get together and fall in love? Act 2 begins with Taylor and her crush sitting on a bench before school. He sweetly pushes her hair out of her face, and then in this tender moment, we can see on Taylor's face that she may seize this opportunity to reveal her feelings about how she feels about him. But cue plot point number three, the midpoint, which raises the stakes and or creates greater opposition to achieving the story goal. Taylor's plans are abruptly foiled as his hotshot girlfriend pulls up in her convertible. Neighbor crush runs to his girlfriend and kisses her, and Taylor's disheartened. And we're disheartened too. They seem to have patched things up and Taylor missed her chance to share her feelings. But we move into the second half of Act Two and things start to turn around again. Now we're at a high school football game. The crush makes a big play and goes to his girlfriend only to be rejected for another guy. And this triggers our plot point number four, the climax, the culmination of our hero's efforts to achieve their goals. Taylor, now back in her room, almost gives in and accepts that she will always be that insecure girl that we saw at the beginning of the story. But at the last minute, she changes her mind and decides to be the person that she dreams she can be. And so we enter the final act, Act Three. It's prom night now, and Taylor has taken off her glasses and transformed Cinderella style into a lovely gowned, beautiful woman. And it's time for plot point number five, the Act Three twist, the final reversal which seals the fate of our hero. Taylor reveals her I love you note, and the crush reveals that he had written an I love you note too. Beautiful, poetic, happy ending. But successful storytelling isn't just about character and plot. It's also, of course, about the audience too.
I think as a songwriter, there is that urge to connect. There is that urge to say, like, this is how I feel sometimes, and then have fans say, oh my God, like I feel that way sometimes too.
Taylor purposefully geared her first albums to an audience that country music had long neglected. Young women, an audience of her peers actually, and her vulnerable diary-like storytelling around her own experiences struck a lasting bond with them.
We would read on her MySpace page where girls were saying, oh my gosh, it's like you read my diary. And that's the key, when you can touch into your fans so much that they think every song is about them, it's very special, I remember.
In the end, it was the combination of classic story structure, speaking from the heart, and addressing a specific audience that allowed You Belong With Me to climb the charts the way it did. And as Taylor grew into a cultural icon, her fans evolved with her too, continually rooting for the girl they became friends with during Fearless. And when she transitioned from country to pop music, her audience stood by her. And when she fell off the grid because of a social media controversy in 2016, fans were waiting with open arms when she returned to the stage. That's because with each song and each story that Taylor tells, fans get a glimpse of Taylor's journal. And it's this honest material that allows us to find our own truths in her experiences. If you want to learn about another prolific artist, check out my video on how to take notes like Kendrick Lamar.